हेलो फ्रेंड्स फ्रेंड्स, टुडे यू आर गोइंग टू लर्न वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट प्रोसेस इन डेवलपमेंटल बायोलॉजी एंड दिस इज द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ दिस टॉपिक एंड द टॉपिक इज फर्टिलाइजेशन. हियर यू विल स्टडी द एक्सटर्नल टाइप ऑफ फर्टिलाइजेशन एंड द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ दिस External type of fertilization is sea urchin. So first of all, subscribe and share my channel. Let's go. So fertilization is what? It is a process whereby this process, the gametes, that is the male gamete, that is a sperm and egg, fuse together to begin the creation of a new organism. So we can know that it perform two functions. The first is sex, that is the combining of genes derived from two parents, and second is reproduction, that is the generation of a new organism. The first function of fertilization is to transmit genes from parent to offspring, that is the progeny, and second function is to initiate in the egg cytoplasm those reactions that permit development to proceed. So fertilization process consists of four major events. The first event is contact and recognition between sperm and egg. So in most cases, this ensures that the sperm and egg are of the same species. Second is regulation of sperm entry into the egg. Only one sperm nucleus can ultimately unite with the egg nucleus. And this second event is usually accomplished by allowing only one sperm to enter the egg and actively inhibiting any others from entering. Third event is fusion of the genetic material of sperm and egg. And fourth event is activation of egg metabolism to start development. Now, first event is contact and recognition between sperm and egg. So, recognition of egg and sperm. The interaction of sperm and egg generally it involves five steps. What are these five steps? First is chemoattraction of the sperm to the egg by soluble molecules secreted by the egg. Second is exocytosis of the sperm, acrosomal vesicle and release of its enzymes. Third is binding of the sperm to the extracellular matrix, vitelline envelope or zona pellucida of the egg. Fourth is passes of the sperm through this extracellular matrix. Fifth is fusion of the egg and sperm cell membranes. Now this diagram, the right side, shows the summary of the events leading to the fusion of egg and sperm cell membranes in sea urchin fertilization, which is external type. In the first step, you can see here in the diagram that the sperm is chemotactically attracted to and activated by the egg. Now, second and third, these steps, you know, in this it is showing that contact with the egg jelly triggers the acrosome reactions, which permits the acrosomal process to form and release proteolytic enzymes. In the fourth step, the sperm adheres to the vitelline envelope and lyses a hole in it. And in the fifth step, the sperms adhere to the egg cell membrane and fuses with it. The sperm pronucleus can now enter the egg cytoplasm. So many marine organisms release their gametes into the environment. Now, sperm attraction. So, species-specific sperm attraction has been reported in numerous species, which include cnidarians, that is cylindrates, mollusks, echinoderms, amphibians, and urochordates, such as Hardmania. And in many species, sperm are attracted towards eggs of their species by chemotaxis, that is by following a gradient of chemical secreted by the egg. These oocytes control not only the types of sperm they attract, but also the time at which they attract them, releasing the chemotactic factor only after they reach maturation. Now, the mechanisms of chemotaxis differ among species, and chemotactic molecules are different even in closely related species. In sea urchins, sperm motility is acquired only after the sperm are spawned. As long as sperm cells are in the testes, they cannot move because their internal pH is kept low, about 7.2, by the high concentration of carbon dioxide in the gonads. However, once a sperm are spawned into seawater, their pH is elevated to about 7.6, which results in activation of the dynein ATPase. The splitting of ATP provides the energy for the flagella to wave, and the sperm begin swimming vigorously, but the ability to move does not provide the sperm with a direction. In Gynodermata, this direction is provided by small chemotactic peptides, which is known as SAP, meaning sperm activating peptides, SAP, S-A-P. And one such SAP is ReSAC. This is ReSAC is a sperm activating peptide, which is, 14 amino acid peptide that has been isolated from the egg jelly of the sea urchin Abdacea tranquillata. And ReSAC, the SAP diffuses readily from the egg jelly into seawater and has a profound effect at very low concentrations when added to a suspension of Abdacea sperm. When a drop of seawater containing Abdacea sperm is placed on a microscopic slide, the sperm generally swim in circle about 50 millimeter in diameter. Within seconds after a small amount of ReSAC is injected, sperm migrate into the region of the injection and congregate there. So, as ReSAC diffuses from the area of injection, more sperm are recruited into the growing cluster. ReSAC is specific for this, Abdacea pancreata, and does not attract sperm of other sea urchin species. An analogous compound, SuperAct, has been isolated from the purple sea urchin, that is Strongylo centrotus purpuratus. So this Abdacea pancreata sperm have receptors in their cell membranes that bind ReSAC. When the extracellular side of the receptor binds ReSAC, it activates latent guanylyl cyclase in the cytoplasmic side of the receptor. Now, active guanylyl cyclase causes the sperm cell to produce more cyclic GMP, that is cyclic GMP, which is a compound that activates a calcium channel in the cell membrane of the sperm tail, which permits the influx of calcium ion from the seawater into the tail. These sperm-specific calcium channels are encoded by CATSPR genes. These genes are CATSPR, C-A-T-S-P-E-R, CATSPR genes, the same genes that control the direction of sperm migration in mice and humans. The increase in cyclic GMP and calcium ion activate both the mitochondrial ATP generating apparatus and the dynein ATPase that stimulates flagellar movement in the sperm. In addition, the sperm sense the SAP gradient by curving their tails, interspersing straight swimming with a turn to sense the environment. The binding of a single ReSAC molecule may be enough to provide direction for the sperm, which swim up a concentration gradient of this compound until they reach the egg. Therefore, we can say that ReSAC functions as a sperm attracting peptide as well as a sperm activating peptide. This diagram on the right side here, you can see here, this shows the ReSAC from Abdacea egg jelly. It binds to its receptor on the sperm, and this activate the receptor guanylyl cyclase RGC, this one activity, forming intracellular cyclic GMP in the sperm. The cyclic GMP opens calcium channels in the sperm cell membrane, which allow calcium ion to enter the sperm, and the influx of calcium ion activate sperm motility, and the sperm swims up and resect gradient towards the egg. So now come to acrosomal reaction. In most marine invertebrates, the acrosome reaction has two components. First component is fusion of the acrosomal vesicle with the sperm cell membrane. So, which is an exocytosis that results in the release of the contents of the acrosomal vesicle, and second is extension of the acrosomal process. The acrosome reaction in sea urchins is initiated by contact of the sperm with the egg jelly. Contact causes the exocytosis of the sperm's acrosomal vesicle. The proteolytic enzymes and proteasomes, that is protein digesting complexes, therefore release, digest a path through the jelly coat to the cell, to the egg cell surface. And once the sperm reaches the egg surface, the acrosomal process adheres to the vitelline envelope and tethers the sperm to the egg. It is possible that proteasomes from the acrosome coat the acrosomal process, permitting it to digest the vitelline envelope at the point of attachment and proceed towards the egg. In sea urchins, the acrosome reaction is started by sulfate containing polysaccharides in the egg jelly that bind to specific receptors located directly above the acrosomal vesicle on the sperm cell membrane. These polysaccharides are often highly species specific, and egg jelly factors from one species of sea urchin generally fail to activate the acrosome reaction even in closely related species. Therefore, we can understand that the activation of the acrosome reaction serves as a barrier to interspecies and therefore unviable fertilization. This is important when numerous species inhabit the same habitat and when their spawning seasons overlap. In Strongylocentrotus purpuratus, that is echinoderm, the sea urchin, the acrosome reaction is initiated by a repeating polymer of fucose sulfate. When this sulfated polysaccharide binds to its receptor on the sperm, the receptor activates three sperm membrane proteins. And you know that first is a calcium transport channel that allow calcium ion to enter the sperm head. Second is a sodium hydrogen exchanger that pumps sodium ions into the sperm as it pumps hydrogen ions out. Third is a phospholipase enzyme that makes another second messenger, the phospholipid inositol 1,4,5 triphosphate, that is IP3. IP3 is able to release calcium ion from inside the sperm, probably from within the acrosome itself. The elevated calcium level in a relatively basic cytoplasm triggers the fusion of the acrosomal membrane with the adjacent sperm cell membrane, releasing enzymes that can lyse a path through the egg jelly to the vitelline envelope. The second part of the acrosome reaction involves the extension of the acrosomal process by the polymerization of globular actin molecules into actin filaments. The influx of calcium ion is thought to activate the protein Rho-B in the acrosomal region and mid-piece of the sperm. This GTP binding protein helps organize the actin cytoskeleton in many types of cells and is thought to be active in polymerizing actin to make the acrosomal process. You know, this diagram on the right side, it shows the acrosome reaction in sea urchin sperm. What is happening in the first step, that is the portion of the acrosomal membrane lying directly beneath the sperm cell membrane fuses with the cell membrane to release the content of the acrosomal vesicle. So this is acrosomal membrane, and you know this is globular actin. So acrosomal enzymes are released, and actin molecules assemble to produce microfilament, extending the acrosomal process outwards. So this is the process which is happening here. Now, the recognition of the egg's extracellular coat. The sea urchin sperm's contact with an egg's jelly coat provides the first set of species-specific recognition events, that is, sperm attraction, activation, and acrosome reaction. Another critical species-specific binding event must occur once the sperm has penetrated the egg jelly. Its acrosomal process contacts the surface of the egg. The acrosomal protein mediating this recognition in sea urchin is an insoluble and 30,500 Dalton protein known as binding. In 1977, Vancouver and Coe et al. Isolated binding from the acrosome of Strongylocentrotus purpuratus and found it to be capable of binding to de-jellied eggs of the same species. And further sperm binding like egg jelly polysaccharides is usually species specific, and binding isolated from the acrosomes of this S purpuratus binds to its own de-jellied eggs but not to those of S franciscanus, that is another species. Bindin and other gamete recognition proteins are among the fastest evolving proteins known. Even when even when closely related urchin species have near identity of every other protein, their bindins and bindin receptors may have diverged significantly. Now, the fusion of the egg and sperm cell membrane. Once the sperm has traveled to the egg and undergone the acrosome reaction, the fusion of the sperm cell membrane with the egg cell membrane can begin. Sperm-egg fusion appears to cause the polymerization of actin in the egg to form a fertilization cone. Fusion is an active process and often mediated by a specific fusogenic protein, and in sea urchin, bindin plays a second role as a fusogenic protein. In addition to recognizing the egg, bindin contains a long stretch of hydrophobic amino acid near its amino terminus, and this region is able to fuse phospholipid vesicles in vitro. Under the ionic conditions present in the mature unfertilized egg, bindin can cause the sperm and egg membranes to fuse. Now come to phenomena that is monospermy. So in the normal case, monospermy, only one sperm enters the egg and the haploid sperm nucleus combines with the haploid egg nucleus to form the diploid nucleus of the fertilized egg. Zygote, restoring the chromosome number appropriate for the species. During cleavage, the centriole provided by the sperm divides to form the two poles of the mitotic spindle while the egg-derived centriole is degraded. Now, polyspermy, that is in most animals, any sperm that enters the egg can provide a haploid nucleus and a centriole. The entrance of multiple sperm, that is polyspermy, leads to diestrous consequences in most disasters. It lead to very unfortunate consequences in most of the organisms. So in sea urchin, fertilization by two sperm results in a triploid nucleus in which each chromosome is represented three times rather than twice. Each sperm centriole divides to form the two poles of a mitotic apparatus. So instead of a bipolar mitotic spindle separating the chromosome into two cells, triploid chromosomes may be divided into as many as four cells, with some cells receiving extra copies of certain chromosomes while other cells lack them. Now, this diagram shows the aberrant development in a diespermic sea urchin egg. Step in the first step, that is fusion of the three haploid nuclei, and each contain 18 chromosomes, and the division of the two sperm centriole to form four centrosomes, that is mitotic poles. And B and C, this stage and this stage shows the 54 chromosomes randomly assort on the four spindle. And D, this stage at anaphase of the first division, the duplicated chromosomes are pulled to the four poles. And E step, it shows the four cells containing different numbers and types of chromosomes are formed, thereby causing the early death of the embryo. So this results in the disintegrating cells and death of the embryo. And in the G stage, this one, the first metaphase of a diaspermic sea urchin egg akin to D step, the microtubules are stained green in color, the DNA stain appear orange, and the triploid DNA is being split into four chromosomally unbalanced cells instead of the normal two cells with equal chromosome complement. And step H shows the human diaspermic egg at first mitosis. The four centrioles are stained yellow, while the microtubules of the spindle apparatus and of the two sperm tails, these are stained red. The three sets of chromosomes divided by these four poles are stained blue. Now, fast block to polyspermy. In the sea urchin egg, fast reaction accompanies by an electric change in the cell's egg cell membrane is followed by a slower reaction caused by the exocytosis of the cortical granules. So the fast block to polyspermy is achieved by a change in the electric potential of the egg cell membrane that occurs immediately upon the entry of a sperm. Once one sperm has fused with the egg, soluble material from that sperm, probably nicotinic acid, adenine dinucleotide phosphate, that is NADP, acts to change the egg cell membrane, that is sodium channels are closed, thereby preventing the entry of sodium ion into egg, and the egg cell membrane maintains an electrical voltage gap between the interior of the egg and its environment. This resting membrane potential is generally about 70 millivolt, which is expressed as minus 70 millivolt because the inside of the cell is negatively charged with respect to the exterior. Within 1 to 3 seconds after the binding of the first sperm, the membrane potential shift to a positive level about plus 20 millivolt with respect to the exterior. And the shift from negative to positive is the result of a small influx of sodium ion into the egg through newly opened sodium channels. Sperm cannot fuse with egg cell membranes that have a positive resting potential. So the shift means that no more sperm can fuse to the egg. The fast block to polyspermy can also be circumvented by lowering the concentration of sodium ion in the surrounding water. So, if the supply of the sodium ions is not sufficient to cause the positive shift in membrane potential, polyspermy takes place. An electric block to polyspermy also occurs in frog, but probably not in most mammals. The slow block to polyspermy, that is cortical reactions. So, since the membrane potential of the sea urchin egg remains positive for only about a minute, so this brief potential shift is not sufficient to prevent polyspermy permanently, and polyspermy can still occur if the sperm bound to the vitelline envelope are not somehow removed. This sperm removal is accomplished by the cortical granule reaction, which is known as slow block to polyspermy. So how does it happen? So this slower mechanical block to polyspermy becomes active about a minute after the first successful sperm egg fusion, and this reaction is found in many animal species including sea urchin and most mammals. directly beneath the egg, sea urchin egg cell membrane are about 15,000 cortical granules, each about 1 micrometer in diameter. Upon a sperm entry, cortical granules fuse with the egg cell membrane and release their contents into the space between the cell membrane and the fibrous mat of vitelline envelope. Proteins and several proteins are released by the cortical granules exocytosis. One of these, the enzymes cortical granule serine protease, cleaves the protein post that connects the vitelline envelope proteins to the egg cell membrane. It also clips off the binding receptor and any sperm attached to them. The components of the cortical granules bind to the vitelline envelope to form a fertilization envelope. The fertilization envelope starts to form at the site of sperm entry and continues its expansion around the egg. This process starts about 20 seconds after sperm attachment and is complete by the end of the first minute of fertilization. Now, the fertilization envelope is elevated from the cell membrane by mucopolysaccharides released by the cortical granules. These viscous compounds absorb water to expand the space between the cell membrane and the fertilization envelope so that the envelope moves radially away from the egg. The fertilization envelope is then stabilized by cross-linking adjacent proteins through egg-specific peroxidase enzymes and a transglutaminase released from the cortical granules. This cross-linking allows the egg and early embryo to resist the shear forces of the ocean intertidal waves. As this is happening, a fourth set of cortical granules proteins, including hyaline, forms a coating around the egg. The egg extends elongated microvilli whose tips attach to this hyaline layer, which provides support for the blastomeres during cleavage. In sea urchin and mammals, the rise in calcium ion concentration responsible for the cortical granule reaction is not due to an influx of calcium into the egg but comes from within the egg itself. The entire release of calcium ion is complete within roughly 30 seconds and free calcium ion is sequestered shortly after being released. In sea urchin eggs, in sea urchin and vertebrates, but not snail and worms, the calcium ion responsible for the cortical granule reaction is stored in the endoplasmic reticulum of the egg. In sea urchins and frogs, this reticulum is pronounced in the cortex and surrounds the cortical granules. As soon as calcium ion is released from the endoplasmic reticulum, the cortical granules fuse with the cell membrane above them. And the right side, this diagram shows the cortical granule exocytosis and formation of the sea urchin fertilization envelope. So, in this diagram, it is shown this is the schematic events which leads to the formation of the fertilization envelope. So, as cortical granules undergoes exocytosis, they release cortical granule serine protease, that is CGSP. And CGSP, this is an enzyme that cleaves the protein linking the vitelline envelope to the cell membrane. Mucopolysaccharides released by the cortical granules form an osmotic gradient, causing water to enter and swell the space between the vitelline envelope and the cell membrane. The enzyme UDX1 in the former cortical granule membrane catalyzes the formation of hydrogen peroxide, the substrate for soluble, ovoperoxidase, that is OVOP. And OVOP and transglutaminases, that is TG, hardens the vitelline envelope, now called the fertilization envelope. So here you can see these all reactions take place. And B and C, this shows the transmission. This is the photographs taken from the transmission electron microscope. and the cortex of an unfertilized a sea urchin egg and the same region of a recently fertilized egg. The raised fertilization envelope and the point at which the cortical granules have fused with the egg cell membranes of the egg. This is shown as arrow. So now activation of egg metabolism in sea urchin egg. And you know, these events happen in the cytoplasm and occur without the involvement of the parental nuclei. In addition to initiating the slow block to polyspermy through the cortical granule exocytosis, the release of calcium ion that occurs when the sperm enters the egg is critical for activating the egg's metabolism and initiating development. Calcium ion release the inhibitors from maternally stored messages, permitting these messenger RNA to be translated. They also release the inhibition of nuclear division, thereby allowing the cleavage to occur. Indeed, throughout the animal kingdom, calcium ions are used to activate development during fertilization. So, a soluble factor from the sperm is introduced into the egg at the time of cell fusion, and this substance activates the egg by changing the ionic composition of the cytoplasm, for example, in mammals. The other mechanism is that the sperm binds to receptors on the egg cell surface and changes their conformation, therefore initiating reactions within the cytoplasm that activate the egg, for example, sea urchin. So throughout the animal kingdom, it has been found that the inositol 1,4,5 triphosphate, that is IP3, is the primary agent for releasing calcium ion from intracellular storage. And this diagram on the right side shows the probable mechanism of egg activation. In both cases, a phospholipase C, that is PLC, is activated and makes IP3 and diacylglycerol, that is DAG. And this A stage, it is the activation after gamete membrane fusion. So here, calcium ion release and egg activation by activated PLC. Directly from the sperm or by a substance from the sperm that activate egg PLC, for example, in mammals. And the second stage, this is the activation prior to gamete fusion. So in this, the binding receptors, perhaps acting through a G protein, activates tyrosine kinase and TK, that is an SRC kinase, which activate PLC. So example, it is the example, this is the example of sea urchin. So these are the two examples. So it has been found that the inositol 1,4,5 triphosphate, that is IP3, is the primary agent for releasing calcium ion from intracellular storage, and the membrane phospholipid phosphatidyl inositol 4,5 biphosphate, that is PIP2, is split by the enzyme phospholipase C, that is PLC, to yield two active compounds, IP3 and diacylglycerol, that is DAG. IP3 is able to release calcium ion into the cytoplasm by opening the calcium channels of the endoplasmic reticulum. DAG activates protein kinase C, which in turn activates a protein that exchanges sodium ions for hydrogen ions, raising the pH of the egg. This sodium-hydrogen exchange pump also requires calcium ion, and the result of PLC activation is therefore the liberation of the calcium ion and the alkalinization of the egg and both of the compounds. This activation recreates IP3 and DAG are involved in the initiation of development. In sea urchin eggs, IP3 is formed initially at the site of sperm entry and can be detected within seconds of sperm egg attachment. And the diagram, you know, this diagram is showing the roles of inositol phosphate in releasing calcium from the endoplasmic reticulum and the initiation of development. You know, phospholipase C, this enzyme splits PIP2 into IP3 and DAG. This is DAG and this is IP3. So IP3 releases calcium from the endoplasmic reticulum, and DAG actually, with the assistance from the released calcium ion, activate the sodium hydrogen exchange pump in the membrane. So IP3 responsive calcium channel have been found in the egg endoplasmic reticulum. And this IP3 formed at the site of, you know, sperm entry is thought to bind to IP receptors in these calcium channels, and effects you know, a local release of calcium ion. So once released, calcium ion can diffuse directly, or it can facilitate the release of more calcium ion by binding to calcium triggered calcium release receptor, also located in the cortical endoplasmic reticulum. So these receptors release stored calcium ion when they bind calcium ion. So binding calcium ion releases more calcium ion, which binds to more receptors, and so on. The resulting wave of calcium release is propagated throughout the cell, starting at the point of sperm entry. And the cortical granules, which fuse with the cell membrane in the presence of high calcium ion concentrations, respond with the wave of exocytosis that follows the calcium wave. IP3 released calcium ion is both necessary and sufficient for initiating the wave of calcium release. So a question arises here that what activates PLC? So if IP3 is necessary for calcium ion release and phospholipase C is required in order to generate IP3, then what activate PLC? So it has been found that the active PLC in echinoderms is a member of the gamma family of PLC. Inhibitors that specifically block PLC gamma inhibit IP3 production as well as calcium ion release. So membrane bound kinases, SRC kinases, and GTP binding proteins play a critical role in this reaction. Now, effect of calcium release. The influx, that is flux of calcium across the egg, activates a programmed set of metabolic events. In early responses, we see that the contact or fusion of a sea urchin sperm and egg activates two major blocks to polyspermy, the first block mediated by sodium influx into the cell, and the cortical granule reaction, that is slow block mediated by the intracellular release of calcium ion. So the same release of the calcium ion responsible for the cortical granules reaction is also responsible for the re-entry of the egg into the cell cycle and the reactivation of egg protein synthesis. So, you know, calcium ion, calcium level, and they also increase. And in almost all the species, this occurs as a wave or succession of waves that sweep across the egg, beginning at the site of sperm egg fusion. Calcium release activates a series of metabolic reactions that initiate embryonic development. So one of these is the activation of the enzyme NAD plus kinase, which converts NAD plus to NADP plus, since NADP plus but not NADP, NAD plus can be used as a coenzyme for lipid biosynthesis. Such a conversion has important consequences for lipid metabolism and therefore may be important in the construction of many new cell membranes required during cleavage. UDX1, the enzyme responsible for the reduction of oxygen to cross-link the fertilization envelope, is also NADPH dependent. It helps regenerate glutathione and ovothiols molecules that may be crucial scavengers of free radicals that could otherwise damage the DNA of the egg and early embryo. And in late responses, that is resumption of protein and DNA synthesis, the late responses of fertilization include the activation of a new burst of DNA and protein synthesis. In sea urchin, the fusion of egg and sperm causes the intracellular pH to increase. This rise in intracellular pH begins with a second influx of sodium ion from seawater, which results in a 1:1 exchange between these sodium ions and hydrogen ions from inside the egg. This loss of hydrogen ion causes the pH within the egg to rise, pH increase, and calcium ion elevation act together to stimulate new DNA and protein synthesis. Now, fusion of genetic material in sea urchin. After the sperm and egg cell membranes fuse, the sperm nucleus and its centriole separate from the mitochondria and flagellum. The mitochondria and the flagellum disintegrate inside the egg, so very few, if any, sperm-derived mitochondria are found in developing or adult organism. Therefore, although each gamete contributes a haploid genome to the zygote, the mitochondrial genome is transmitted primarily by the maternal parent. In almost all animals, the centrosome needed to produce the mitotic spindle of the subsequent divisions is derived from the sperm centriole. The fertilization in sea urchin eggs occurs after the second meiotic division. So there is already a haploid female pronucleus present. When the sperm enters the egg cytoplasm, once inside the egg, the sperm nucleus undergoes a dramatic transformation as it decondenses to form the haploid male pronucleus. First, the nuclear envelope degenerates, exposing the compact sperm chromatin to the egg cytoplasm kinases. From the egg cytoplasm, phosphorylate the sperm-specific histone proteins, permitting them to decondense. The decondensed histones are then replaced by egg-derived cleavage stage histone, and this exchange permits the decondensation of the sperm chromatin. One decondensed, the DNA adheres to the nuclear envelope, where DNA polymerase can initiate replication. After the sea urchin sperm enters the egg cytoplasm, the sperm nucleus separates from the tail and rotates 180 degrees so that the sperm centriole is between the developing male pronucleus and the egg pronucleus. The sperm centriole and acts as a microtubule organizing center, extending its own microtubules and integrating them with the egg microtubule to form an ester. And microtubules extend throughout the egg and contact the female pronucleus, at which point the two pronuclei migrate towards each other. Their fusion forms the diploid zygote nucleus. DNA synthesis can begin either in the pronuclear stage or after the formation of the zygote nucleus, and depends on the level of calcium ion released earlier in fertilization. At this point, the diploid nucleus has formed. DNA synthesis and protein synthesis have commenced, and the inhibitions to cell division have been removed. Now, the cell urchin can now begin to form a multicellular organism. So, this is all about the all the events I have covered in the fertilization in the sea urchin egg, which is external type, that is occurs in the seawater. So this is all about, and this is the all about the part first. Now share and subscribe, and in the next lecture we will discuss the example of mammals. That is all the events occurring in mammalian fertilization. So, thank you very much.